Salutations, fellow readers, writers, and killers of time on YouTube. My name is Martha Jones, and I sit before you today, technically wearing a bow tie, as I use the androgynous sounds of my voice to share with you a few words about Confessions of a Reluctant World Builder. The first and most disgraceful of these confessions is that while I have been writing genre fiction for a while, I am not a natural-born world builder. But as a natural-born underwriter, it is worth it for me to learn. Because word count is a thing, and particularly in fantasy and sci-fi, readers are used to lots and lots of detail. Odds are actually pretty strong that if you have stumbled across this video, it is not the first that you have encountered on your writing journey that has to do with world building, but in case it is. World building is kind of a blanket expression for details included by the writer to make the fictional world seem more real and expansive to the reader. Some writers are infamous for laboriously building their worlds first, then imagining the stories that could take place in said world. But if you're not careful, you could end up in a world-building rabbit hole and never get around to writing your story. Which might actually make you really well-suited for writing role-playing games, but that is another video for another time and maybe another creator. Conversely, one consistent problem I have in my own writing is that my characters tend to live in their own little production of our town. No scenery, few props, maybe a costume here or there, but for the most part the characters live in a void. And the audience does the heavy lifting of setting the scene in their heads. In order to combat this Spartan writing tendency and not get bogged down by every tuft of hair or leaf of grass, I tend to inflate my descriptions as I go and answer random questions about a given scene as though I was my own horde of internet trolls. Why is there no pandemic in your fairy tale? Your MC was assigned princess at birth. You might as well be an attack helicopter as much sense as that makes.
Plot hole, magic's not a thing.
Okay, maybe it's not worth humoring the entire horde of trolls. Would you accept a small regiment? The thing is, some tropes and contrivances are necessary in order to propel your plot forward, and the readers of your preferred genre will usually cut you some slack. But in order for them to do that, it helps to get some cohesive details down as a structure on which you spread your tropes, which is where a good base knowledge of world building can be a giant help. Like I said, I am no expert, and this stuff does not come 100% naturally to me, but by a curious whim of fate, I recently had the opportunity to play both Worldbuilder and a troll in regards to a small portion of someone else's story. Therefore, if you are open to taking the journey with me, I would like to tell you a little bit about my process while writing a thing, and how some seemingly trivial details from another author's world helped me do it. Ready? I'm not. Let's do it! And if you're a fan of genre fiction, don't even play like this is the most boring thing you have sat through in order to get better books. I happen to know that some of you have read The Silmarillion, Dune, and 2001 Space Odyssey without the help of Sir Clifford Notes. With a hey, nonny, nonny, and away we go. So this last October, I was in touch with my girl, Amanda Lamkin, who is fastidiously working on her sequel to The Incredible Adventures of Absolutely Normal. And she's actually been super gracious about my inexcusably troll-like behavior regarding the songs of her fantasy realm, enduring such criticisms as, "How about a chorus to tie these verses together, boss?" Or, "I know he's Scottish, but literally no one reacts this well to the playing of chanter music in confined spaces." Seriously, I've played chanter music in confined spaces, and the sound of it is enough to turn grown men into jellyfish. Oh, who took the calcium out of my spinal column? However, this time I do believe she anticipated a modicum of my trollitude, as evidenced by her text to me that said the following. "Oh, great songstress. I just stumbled upon my group singing the national song of Guithenia. Problem, I don't know the national song of Guithenia. Until this moment, I didn't know there was a national song of Guithenia." Throughout the texts that followed, she was actually a super good sport and put up with a lot of silly world-building questions that, in hindsight, were ridiculous from the get-go. Things like, were there any famous battles fought in Guithenia? Or, what was the Guithenian version of the Alamo? If you're a fan of George R.R. Martin or J.R.R. Tolkien, you might be thinking, well, of course there were battles. Fantasy realm without a battle is about as entertaining as The Three Little Pigs without a big bad wolf. But see, it's like a middle grade novel, possibly geared toward kiddos and their parents who are all, "I'd prefer my 12-year-old's blood remain uncurdled for now, thank you very much." Whatever. But the reason I was interested in battles is because I had in mind the national anthems of the US and of France, both of which were written in their respective revolutions, and whose lyrics kind of reflect that. You know that part of Les Mis where all the idealistic college boys are going, "The blood of the marches will water the meadows of France." That's kind of a direct reference to La Marseillaise. Next, I started pondering songs that a nation might find dear but aren't technically national anthems, like Flower of Scotland. I understand that if you want to be a buzzkill at the pub, start playing Flower of Scotland and watch all the Scots drop their drinks and stand at attention. On further probings for details, my Amanda suggested that I write something more like a hymn. Not a bad suggestion. Absolutely Normal is not unlike the Chronicles of Narnia in that it has religious overtones that range from the subliminal to the downright liminal. As far as that all concerns me, I am an amoral storyteller who does not care if there are or are not religious overtones as long as it is good storytelling. My goal was not by any means to purge the religious overtones, but it's not my place to put them in. I didn't want to write a good Christian song, I wanted to write a good song, and one that would alienate as few readers as possible. So, for those of you keeping track at home, my goal was to write a secular hymn for a fictional world that doubles as a national anthem. Piece of cake. Right in the face. Then, at some point in the exchanges between my Amanda and me, she mentioned in passing an in-story legend about a gigantic mine that collapsed and would have killed a whole lot of people if the king's child hadn't stepped up and led a rescue mission. And while there could absolutely be a rich history of mining songs anywhere mining has transpired over the last couple hundred years, the tradition I happen to know the most about is the one from the UK.
Johnny Miner, you were born never to see the rising dawn.
I'm going down, underground, down underground.
So I went back, as they say, to the old drawing board and came up with a song that tells the story of the Gwythinian miners. And while I cannot boast that the way I came up with the folk song for this make-believe world is in any way the way other people should world build, I feel like the ability to brainstorm, ask questions, come up with convincing answers, and to see connections are all super helpful in laying the foundation for the world you're building. The video you're watching is about a song, but it's a song that would not exist were it not for a whole lot of things being taken to account about that fictional world. Is this song a part of your country's oral history? If so, is it more likely to be heard by a merchant or a vagabond? Is this a state-approved song, or is it popular because it makes the people in charge angry? Once you ask one question, often it leads to another and another. And whether or not you choose to use any of this in your story, sometimes the world-building you do is not for your audience. It's for you, to make the world seem more real to you as you are writing it. Because if you don't find it believable, who is going to? Anyway, with minimal further ado, and lest I be guilty of planting Chekhov's folk song this whole time, here is an old Gwythinian folk song. Title to be determined later. Would you accept yours, mine, and ours? I wouldn't either.
O dusty miner, lost in labyrinths of stone in search of riches, to say to greed that was not your own, look past the depth and through the darkness may starlight find you and bring you home. O stalwart mountain, your foundation seems so sure until we shook them with our drill and with our bore, and through the caverns the rocks came crashing. For our generation, death was sure. The battered champion, lost in rubble, found love once dead and buried. By your word did the mountains move, and then you led us through the peril. For you and no other could the darkness reprove.
As always, thank you for giving these videos a shot. I post whenever the day job allows. If you happen to be a songwriter who considers yourself trollier than thou and would like to take a shot at writing a Gwythinian national anthem better than the way you saw it done here, feel free to leave a link and I will be privileged to be owned on the internet by you. But in the meantime, take it easy. Loves you. Bye.
Like my channel, buy my crap. Doo-da, doo-da. There's no time to take a nap. Oh, the doo-da day. Hey!
So, in case you're wondering why I felt compelled to do my best shot at a bow tie for today's symposium, the Amanda of whom you've heard me speak sent me a card with some of her favorite poems from Dorothy Parker in it. If you are already familiar with Dorothy Parker, good for you. I hope she brings you joy. If you're not familiar with Dorothy Parker, closer to 100 years ago than 10, she wrote for The New Yorker and generated memeable phrases at a rate that would make Oscar Wilde cry. I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. What fresh hell is this? Beauty is only skin deep, but ugly goes clean to the bone. Batman wishes he was as cool as this lady. Anyway, for those of you who are curious what kind of writing is so good that it gets quoted by publishers on a regular basis, a single flower he sent me since we met, all tenderly his messenger he chose. Departed, pure, with scented dew still wet. One perfect rose. I knew the language of the floweret. My fragile leaves, it said, his heart enclose. Love long has fallen for its amulet. One perfect rose. Why is it no one has sent me yet one perfect limousine, do you suppose? Ah, no, it's always just my luck to get one perfect rose.